PMLA, Representations, Transition, Social Text, American Literary History, and American Quarterly. He is the author of Love and Theft, Blackface, Minstrelsy, and the American Working Class, published with Oxford University Press in 1993, with a 20th anniversary edition in 2013. Bob Dylan took the title for his 2001 album, Love and Theft, from that book. Also author of The Disappearing Liberal Intellectual and Black Mirror, The Cultural Contradictions of American Racism, published with Harvard in 2017, a study of the race, culture, and fantasy across the long 20th century. Lott has appeared on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah, CBS Sunday Morning, Turner Classic Movies, C-SPAN Book TV, Al Jazeera TV, and various radio shows and podcasts. Eric, it is truly an honor to have you with us this evening, and I'm delighted that you'll be leading this important conversation for us.
Very happy to be here. Hello, everyone. It's great to be talking to people from coast to coast, as I gather from the chat box, from Los Angeles to Oklahoma City, Chicago, and beyond, maybe. I'm going to read some sections of my talk, but I'll also just be riffing from time to time. So I hope to make this decision and its turnover of information, but also engaging, despite the rather unseemly and unpleasant topic of blackface performance, blackface minstrelsy, and its many afterlives, because I think it extends into the present in various ways. But I've called this Blackface from Time to Time. I'll talk about that title in just a moment, but some introductory remarks first. Trigger warning, anyone? At one and the same time, blackface performance is both obviously offensive and enduringly influential. I'd argue that it still surrounds us in many different forms, types of entertainment, and horizons of expectation. Ethnic drag, as we might think of it, in the form of white performers in blackface, but black ones too from time to time, seems to exist in some kind of eternal present. Instances of its performance go back centuries to early modern carnival, 1500s, 1400s, 1600s, mobs, gatherings, what one historian has called primitive rebels, Shakespeare's Othello, obviously. Blackface performance comes into commercial popularity in the United States in the 1820s and 30s. It dominates popular entertainment on stage in the form of the so-called minstrel show all across the 19th century. And it's really hard to overstate how popular the minstrel show was and how much it really dominated stage performance before film. But then blackface performance migrates to Hollywood, Hollywood film, very early in the history of Hollywood, first decade of the 20th century, as well as the music industry for much of the 20th century up to the present day. And it was a global phenomenon extending from Great Britain to South Africa, Japan to Australia. The official censuring of blackface in the 1960s, and not really until the 1960s, rather shockingly, which gave it a new but not altogether straightforward political complexion. The censoring of it in the 60s coincided with its continued, what one might think of as vernacular, reappearance in Halloween costumes and fraternity parties and college yearbooks to this day, where from time to time, blackface makes its seemingly inevitable return. Then there are the recent cases of white North American activists and scholars passing for other, Rachel Doležal most famously, that only thicken the plot. I'd like to talk about the time-to-time temporality of blackface's ongoing present and why American culture seems to require these performances and all that they imply. I'm going to break down my presentation into several sections. One will just be trying to talk about the format and some of the meanings behind what the minstrel show in the 1800s in the United States, mostly in the North, in the urban North, what it looked like, what it meant. But then in subsequent sections, take up Hollywood renditions in blackface and of blackface, some of the Hollywood Halloween instances, particularly in the last decade or so, some of them involving politicians. So I want to talk about blackface's appearance in regard to politicians like Virginia's ex-governor Ralph Northam and even former President Barack Obama. And then if there's time to talk about the case of Rachel Doležal, but we'll see how that goes. So these will be fairly discrete sections, and I'd invite any questions at any time, maybe at the end of each of those little breaks, we could talk for a bit. But first, let me talk a little bit more about the title and just about the understanding of the form of blackface performance. It's really true that it wasn't until the 1960s that it came to be regarded as a suspect and politically offensive practice. Before then, it's quite surprising to go into the library and find scholarly studies. Carl Witke's 1930 book, Tambo in Bones, for example, which is a good book, but it's completely uncritical about what blackface performance was. Sort of takes for granted that it was a mostly accurate depiction of black life in the United States and celebrates the form for its folk authenticity. There are other books too that again are quite learned and useful, like Hans Nathan's Early Negro Minstrelsy, which has sheet music and nails down some of the musical forms and infrastructures the form used, but still quite uncritical about the racism of the form. And it wasn't until really civil rights movement era scholarship and journalism came along in late 1950s, early 1960s, writers like Amiri Baraka, formerly Leroy Jones, that blackface became shorthand for white performers, white entertainment culture, taking advantage of the black image and seeking to own it by way of the blackface mask. Because once you put on, as a white performer, the blackface mask, you have control of that image and you can do pretty much anything with it that you want to. Make it say anything, do anything, seem to be anything, and pass that off as genuine Negro life, quote unquote, as one magazine in the 1850s put it. The first anti-racist, explicitly critical scholarly volume addressing the minstrel show was Robert Toll's book, 1974 book, Blacking Up. And if you're interested in teaching anything about this form, and you have to do that with caution, obviously, I recommend Toll's book because it remains a very solid and accessible and readable study of the form. But I think of blackface from time to time, the phrase from time to time, in a couple of different ways. One is the sense, the obvious sense of it flaring up occasionally, and it still does, unaccountably. Who can say why? It never seems to go away. It seems to exist in some kind of eternal present, in an ongoing present, even though people do or should know that it's an offensive practice. Here it comes again, now and then. There's also, from time to time, there's also a sense of an out-of-timeness in the sense that whenever it does appear, it seems to refer you back to an earlier time. So it gestures back to a time when blackface was okay. And almost invariably, when somebody gets busted for having done blackface, either in the 80s, like Ralph Northam, or more recently, like Dancing with the Stars star Jennifer Huff, they profess ignorance when called on it. Oh, I didn't know it was offensive. Which, A, how is that possible? And B, I don't believe you. But it is the fallback position. But even there, the sense that, oh, I didn't know, gestures back to a different time when it might have seemed just okay to do this. Or in the kind of costuming that you find, it'll throw you back to an earlier time of fashion when whatever black image is being put on the white performer in blackface has kind of rustic clothes or this or that sort of trapping to try and convince you that this character is in some way really in reference to anyone who ever lived as opposed to a complete white fantasy. So there's time to time in that sense too, throwback time, whenever it appears. I will just say quickly that makes it what I think of as an allusive form. It always alludes to earlier times of blackface performance, a time when it was okay to do it, earlier performers, gesturing back to its classic form in the 19th century. Secondly, it seems to me an occasional form. Just pops up these days anyway, not an official entertainment form anymore. It just pops up out of the collective unconscious, it seems. And it often, when you think about these instances, they seem to be motivated by something in the moment that occasioned them. There's some kind of return of the repressed, as Freud might have said. Certainly, there's a kind of appeal to unknowing when someone who's caught doing it says, oh, I didn't know, I'm sorry, I just didn't realize. There's a kind of, whether it's pretend or not, the privilege of ignorance that is reiterated time and again by people who do it and then get caught. As though to suggest that one condition of being white is the privilege of not having to think too much about things like this, not to be accountable in any way. And then finally, from time to time, just has a sense of the casualization of blackface, the way in which it seems so built into the fabric of entertainment industries, sports spectatorship, musical culture in this country, and I'll make reference to some of that in a bit. Even everyday life, when people put on their black voice, and white people put on their black voice, an exaggeratedly black voice. This is the unconscious return, it seems to me, of blackface minstrelsy. And it's just it's kind of like, you know, again, casual, just there, always, time to time. So let me tell you a little bit about, I'm going to read you now just some lines laying out the oh, yes, I'm sorry. Well, I'm getting to my slides. Thanks for that prompt. You're about to get a good slide. Several. The Blackface Minstrel Show, known in the 19th century as, and these are in scare quotes, Negro or Ethiopian minstrelsy, was a hugely popular form of commercial theatrical entertainment in which white men brutally caricatured African Americans for sport and profit. Northern urban stage mimics, such as George Washington Dixon and T.D. Rice, began in the late 1820s and early 1830s, when going to the theater was like going to the movies is now, or used to be. Nobody goes to the movies anymore, I guess. Began to black up, as they called it, with either grease paint or burnt cork, parodying black dress, dance, speech, humor, and song, developing enduring stereotypes such as the happy-go-lucky Southern rustic slave Jim Crow and the ludicrous Northern urban dandy Zip Coon. These images are important. For one thing, Jim Crow, the character, was a plantation slave. That's the image. And you can see the little cabins behind that character's leg in the back. So it's to reference a certain kind of carefree plantation life, as if. But that's a Southern identified character over against this urban and implicitly Northern image of Zip Coon, whose parodic base, unlike the basically dumb, incompetent Southern slave figure, is also inadequate, but inadequate because the Zip Coon character pretends to a station and capabilities that he does not possess. So those are the two types, and they're importantly sectional. Zip Coon, mostly a northern kind of urban figure, even though the South had plenty of cities, obviously. Jim Crow, a southern figure. And this is important because already in the 1830s, when these characters became popular, there was a mapping of the country according to modes of production, for lack of a better term, the slave South and the supposedly free North that would come to blows, less than 30 years later in the Civil War. And indeed, the closer you get to the Civil War in 1861, the more intense the depictions in various ways, minstrel representations of North versus South tend to get. So there's a weird way in which the war takes place on stage as much as in the field. Here, for example, is Rice, Thomas Dartmouth Rice, Daddy Rice, as he was known, at the American Theater on the Bowery. And it's a kind of lower class milieu centered on the Bowery in New York, a very typical kind of location for this kind of performance, even though the fiction was. And you look at journalism of the day and they talk to performers who usually peddle some kind of story about hanging around on plantations and studying the ways of life of the people they're caricaturing, when that was probably mostly not true. All you had to do was go down to the East River wharves, riverfront docks, to see black life, stevedores, and so forth, working next to the river in New York, which is where the form really got its purchase. Not down south, which I think is what the images tend to convey. So those are the early performances, and they're really single performers between the acts of much longer plays. And you can tell there's a kind of, I have a reading of this very complicated lithograph here of Rice in my book, Love and Theft, because I think as much as Rice is center stage in this performance, the people who are crowding the stage, the audience, the spectators, are no less of interest and are also part of the performance. By the 1840s, and usually involving four, sometimes more, performers, began to form. There's some argument over which band was the first, Virginia Minstrels of Dan Emmett and others, or Christie's Minstrels, both of them highly popular in the 1840s. But the fact that it was band is key. And by the 40s, bands or troupes had formed and elaborated the show's basic three-part form, an opening section of songs, dances, broad jokes, and riddles. So a very rock and roll, raucous kind of thing where they come out and they just kind of storm the stage and overwhelm the senses with some rather bawdy humor. And you can see from this sheet music here, like the others I've shown, printed in New York, not elsewhere, that the group is configured in a raucous fashion. They're really attacking their instruments in various ways. Then there was a middle or so-called olio section of novelty set pieces like burlesque sermons or political stump speeches. And then a final extended skit, usually set in the South. And so the show took over the stage as a self-contained show in its own right and took up an evening unto itself, as opposed to being a between the act or entre-act thing. After the Civil War, African-American performers themselves took the stage, and though they performed also in blackface, they reworked as they adopted racist performance conventions. And here come brilliant performers performing in blackface, like George Walker and Burt Williams. A dazzling and very famous duo who performed in Williams, especially in blackface. And there's Burt Williams in 1915 in a film not long ago was discovered, not a full length film, but more than a minute or two, extending to, I think, 15 or so minutes, was recently located of Burt Williams, the silent film. So that was quite a find. But by this final decade, which featured and became famous for its so-called coon shows, the form is beginning to die out. And the minstrel format gave rise to other kinds of performances, particularly black performances, from the likes of, for example, W.C. Handy or Ma Rainey, who in traveling minstrel shows would purvey their work. So it became less of a stage, more of a tent show type format, and began to die out on stage, only to clear the way for blackface's appearance in Hollywood film. There's a film version of Uncle Tom's Cabin, the Harriet Beecher Stowe novel from the 1850s, in 1903, and it's an early and important film. It's not that bad either. Important because of its length. It's really a full-length rendition of the tale the novel has to tell, which, of course, is an anti-slavery novel. And Uncle Tom is played by a white man in blackface. Probably the most famous early film featuring blackface is The Jazz Singer, 1927. Famous also because it's the first talking picture, the first sound picture. There are ways in which you can qualify that statement, but it's the first time audiences had heard a performer speaking on film. And it really stages the whole wearing of blackface by little Jakey Rabinowitz, a Jewish immigrant in New York who wants not to be a cantor and belong to the synagogue like his father, but to enter the entertainment business, which he does by way of the blackface mask. But other performers too, Fred Astaire wore blackface in a tribute to Bill Bojangles Robinson, the dancer, in the film Swing Time. Judy Garland in a picture called Everybody Sing in 1938. Bing Crosby in the film Holiday Inn, from which the hotel chain gets its name, all sported blackface. And it's a tradition that has been variously used, but also played with and ironized by, for example, Melvin Van Peebles in a 1970 film called Watermelon Man. Watermelon Man is hilarious because Godfrey Cambridge, an actual black man, starts the film in whiteface. So the idea is that he's just a white suburbanite. But he admires, even though he's racist, he admires Muhammad Ali, other black athletes, spends time under the sun lamp, tries to get a tan desperately, and is clearly at some level in love with blackness. And Van Peebles, black director, is totally having fun with the idea of white desire for black culture and black life by way of the mask. It turns out in the film that he spends a little bit too long under the sun lamp, and the conceit of the film is that he wakes up one morning having turned black. And so he's horrified, and much of the film is very funny, but also quite melancholic in its way. Plays around with these images and ideas. Spike Lee's Bamboozled is 2000, the year 2000, is the definitive satire of the form, but that didn't put a stop to its appearance in, for example, the film Tropic Thunder, which you may know, the Ben Stiller film with Robert Downey Jr. playing a method actor who's so invested in his part as a black GI that he puts on blackface and is totally making fun of blackface, but it's still using it. Then, of course, there's the famous debacle in which Ted Danson at the Friars Club in 1993, who at the time was dating Whoopi Goldberg, appeared in blackface as a kind of gag and told racist jokes in the presence of Whoopi, which they both claim they wrote together as a kind of parodic effort, which didn't go over too well. But even as recently as a film like Zoolander, Ben Stiller's picture, 2001, doesn't play on blackface much, but you do get a moment when the film talks about Zoolander, the character's former life as a West Virginia miner. And there's a moment when he turns around in the mine and shoots us his black-faced visage. So let me say a word or two about how all this happened, what it might imply. Well, minstrelsy was organized around the borrowing, quite explicit borrowing, of African-American cultural materials, ideas about black life for white dissemination, a borrowing that depends on the material relations of slavery, it seems to me, can't not be related in some fashion to slavery. But also such performance obscured these relations by pretending that slavery and racial dominance generally were amusing, okay, natural, no big deal. This is the basic thrust of blackface, its primary and primordial urgency. And even when people are playing around with it, it seems to me, it carries this basic racist force. Reading between the lines, and if you think back to the celebratory older version of minstrelsy over against the post-1960s critical version of minstrelsy, I think if you steer between those and see its contradictions and its ambivalences, as I try to do, you see other kinds of motives going on. It's always racist, but it's also, an oddly sanctioned space for playing with or making theater out of white interest in Black people and Black culture, to put on Blackness. And it's not just telling racist jokes. It's actually inhabiting the bodies and clothing and so forth, the antics, however imagined they are, of Blackness, often Black maleness, for an audience consisting predominantly of white men. So it's briefly to become Black, to be cool, to be virile, to be humble, whatever your fantasy is, to be abandoned. For all its ridicule, minstrelsy displayed a secret envy of, and I would go so far as to say, possibly even a homoerotic desire for, Black manhood. So Blackface has, you know, and the mechanism of cultural control it exercised over Blackness and Black cultural forms has had a sadly lasting legacy, but it's also provided a channel for Black cultural tropes and modes and modalities to enter the dominant culture also, however crazy that might seem. So that's kind of, and that's why I think of the whole shebang as what I've called love and theft. There's desire and envy and real interest being pursued and displayed here, even as the theft of Black forms of money in entertainment terms, rooted in the kind of theft of Black labor that slavery embodied. This kind of contradiction or dialectic lies at the heart of minstrelsy, I think, and is available still today in all kinds of forms, which we can talk about, which I'll go on to talk about a little bit. But this is kind of my introductory spiel, and if anyone has questions, we might entertain them. If not, I can just go on. There's a question about swing time, Fred Astaire performing the Bojangles Robinson tribute. Don't know about John Bubbles. Where does it fall, rate, or resonate in our discussion? That's a very interesting and peculiar sequence that Astaire does, because it is in tribute to Bill Robinson. But it's grotesquely racist in its depiction, oddly. Which you can have a look at on YouTube because it's there. Just Google it. And it ends, interestingly, with a kind of duel or dance-off between Astaire and this shadow figure behind him, who we might take to be the figure of Robinson. And I won't spoil it as to how it comes out, but it doesn't end well for Bill Robinson. Despite the fact, again, that it's a supposed to be a tribute to Robinson, but again, it's not out of the ordinary in having dual impulses of celebration as well as, how do you want to put it, containment, condescension, competition, certainly. I wouldn't go so far as to say revulsion in this case, although the racism that you get in minstrelsy is often that. But it makes one uneasy to watch in these times. And I can't imagine, you know, a picture came out in 1936. I can't imagine many viewers, even in 1936, feeling altogether comfortable with it. If you think of W.E.B. Du Bois having a look at it in 1936 while he's just published his great book, Black Reconstruction in America, I don't think he would be particularly happy with it. But that's a good, that is a good transition to kind of bigger picture remarks about the Hollywood depictions and use of blackface. You've seen some images, the Jolson, the Judy Garland, the Bing Crosby, but also the Ted Danson and the Ben Stiller. And the Danson and the Stiller are Hollywood liberals trying to poke fun, as is the Robert Downey Jr., trying to poke fun at the form. And it's an open question, your call, as to whether those attempts to be critical are successful or not. But I guess my point would be that those images are so built into Hollywood as a system as to be unavoidable and possibly unavoidably objectionable, even when you're trying to poke fun at it. I mean, there it is again. And in this connection, I would refer you to two interesting books, again, if you're thinking about teaching any of these materials, especially in a 20th century vein. There are two really interesting books that I would recommend. One is, and I'll put it in the chat, a book by Michael Rogan called Blackface, White Noise. Another one is by Nick Salmond, and it's called Birth of an Industry. And I'm sorry I'm too preoccupied with what I'm trying to say to track the audience chat. The old-time cartoons depictions using crows. I think that's a Dumbo reference, if I'm not mistaken. Disney's Dumbo. Anyway, I look forward to looking more at the chat. The Rogan is interesting because Rogan's key point in talking about usages of blackface really in the first half century till the 1950s of blackface in Hollywood. One sort of major point that's worth thinking about, this too if you're teaching film, is that the key transitional moments in Hollywood, really major important moments of great leap forward in Hollywood. And these are the moments, 1903, 1915, 1927, and 1939. 1903, because as I said before, it occasions the release of Uncle Tom's Cabin. A long length, I can't remember it's something like 15, 16, 17 minutes, a rather long film for 1903. And in technical proficiency and in narrative sweep, it's really an advance in movie making. But there's blackface at its heart. 1915, of course, is the moment of D.W. Griffith's Birth of a Nation, a film of more than 2 hours, 2.5 hours, a magisterial work that remains amazing to look at for all the techniques it pioneered and that are still basically function as the grammar of American movie making to this day, but is an explicitly white supremacist film full of blackface images and also black actors who are uniformly evil. Which is to say that blackface there again in this leap forward in 1915, blackface again is key to innovation. 1927 is the first talking film, but there you have it again, a full length, hour and a half, now sound film with blackface at its heart. 1939 is the moment of Gone with the Wind. Not a blackface picture, but certainly full of post-blackface images with mammies, Hattie McDaniel as a mammy, the great Hattie McDaniel, and the great Butterfly McQueen as a kind of ditzy domestic around the house. And the innovation or the leap forward in Hollywood movie making of Gone with the Wind is that it was, I believe, if it wasn't the first, it was one of the first independent productions of David O. Selznick, in full color, very long, complete with intermission, that gestured to modes of movie making that wouldn't become standard until many years later, but which also capitalized on the surplus value, if you will, of racist and blackface image. Nick Salmon's argument in Birth of an Industry, which obviously plays on the title of Birth of a Nation, Griffith's movie, is great on the way Disney and cartooning generally, early cartooning, like, for example, the short Steamboat Willie, one of the first Disney cartoons, still in black and white, it's 1928, it's there on YouTube, is suffused with blackface images. And Nick Salmon is very good in Birth of an Industry on isolating the way in which, like a kind of analytical X-ray, demonstrating the ways in which cartooning generally has been a way of capitalizing on racialized imagery, blackface imagery, and addressing basic constructs of race and ethnicity in the United States, even or most certainly when it doesn't mean to or seem to be doing that. So it's sort of reading against the grain of these cartoons. Now, there's a side question to the whole Hollywood thing, which has to do with the issue of the vexed issue of cultural appropriation, which to my mind often, I mean, it happens all over the place and in all kinds of ways, but often arises in and through music. And I'm thinking here of not just early country music performers in the Grand Ole Opry, like Bill Monroe, who actually wore blackface, or performers like that, early country star Jimmy Rogers, also wore blackface, but more generalized blackface implications. I mean, Josephine Baker in the 1930s, black performer, was stuck into roles that, so to say, minstrelized her. Louis Armstrong seems to me plays with the minstrel mask in all kinds of ways. Neither of them put on blackface, but there's still a kind of blackface aura about them that they have to negotiate and do, I think, really brilliantly. I'm thinking more in the area of cultural appropriation, what one does with videos, for example, or performers like Katy Perry doing This Is How We Do, and the cliched and stereotypical watermelon reference, the black scent of a performer like Meghan Trainor, all about that bass, which became rather controversial. The appropriation of a black vibe, however you want to construe that, that extends back to Elvis Presley, comes up through Mick Jagger, out to Eminem, all the way to somebody like Robin Thicke, whose blurred lines got him in some hot water and ultimately lost him some money because it was determined that blurred lines so capitalized on the Marvin Gaye song Got to Give It Up that the gay estate sued Robin Thicke and was awarded, if I'm not mistaken, $5 million in a lawsuit for that kind of appropriation. And I'm not arguing, I guess, that appropriation is always bad, and very often it's actually hard to identify, but that it's there, and I guess, well, I think many people consider it easy to spot and always to be decried. I would say that conditions of exchange are very complicated, and there's always a context and nuances to be read in such cases, such instances. Now, I don't think this is cultural appropriation so much as, I don't know what it is. But this is Julianne Hough, the Dancing with the Stars person, Halloween 2013, trying to be Crazy Eyes on Orange is the New Black at a Halloween party, private party. She didn't go public. It wasn't on stage. But somebody snapped a picture, and the picture got around, and she was called out for doing it and was forced in increasingly familiar fashion to abase herself and apologize and claim that she didn't really understand that it was objectionable. And I speak to people all the time who maintain that this is not objectionable or don't understand why it's objectionable. White people can mimic white people. That's not objectionable. Why can't you mimic black people? It's just mimicry. Why is this objective? I mean, some of them are relatives of mine. And that's, you know, you can't get mad. All you can do is enjoy the debate. But it seems to me that moments like this are always, at some level, rooted in a prior practice of blackface performance that's really ugly, and that, again, has its material roots in enslavement in this country. And I think it's worth considering what if you yourself are white and you are in a mode to defend such a practice, to ask yourself what your black friends might think of that opinion. And I actually have black friends who would defend it too. So it's not easily solved. But in this connection, there's a funny bit, and this is shameless self-promotion because I'm in it. But the Trevor Noah Daily Show did a segment several years ago, I think it was 2017, with Roy Wood Jr. And the segment was called Race is Not a Costume. And it features Roy Wood Jr., very smart, very funny guy. And it's there. It's available on YouTube. It's about 3 minutes long. And if you're interested, you might have a look at it. And the basic point of it is that you can't put on and take off at will, or doing so is a sign of white privilege, the blackface mask. You can't just put it on, take it off at will, because there are involved implications that motivate it and that are behind it. Have a look if you're interested. But this, of course, Halloween and all, edges into the properly political. And I'm thinking here of former Virginia Governor Ralph Northam, who was busted for when a yearbook from 1984 was discovered with him either in blackface or in a Klansman's outfit. It's still not clear which. And he couldn't remember or didn't want to say. And it was interesting to me that he humbled himself. He apologized. He declared himself more educated and sensitive on the matter than he formerly was. And he was not forced to resign, which I found very interesting. This was just a few years ago, post-Obama. And I want to return to Obama. A more ugly version of the political uses of blackface came in the case of Bobby L. Jolson Berger, an ex-policeman in Baltimore, who for years and years, and there are YouTube videos of him too, performed in blackface as a kind of local service, if you will, in bars and so forth, and protested on many occasions that he didn't see anything wrong with it. Well, you may recall in 2015, a black man in Baltimore named Freddie Gray died at the hands of the police when he was picked up and thrown into a police van and deliberately driven around in a raucous fashion. And he was not restrained inside the van. So he banged around all inside the van and when they opened the van, he was unconscious and later died. So death by cop. Now, these cops who killed Freddie Gray were charged with the crime. And Bobby Berger offered his services as a fundraising effort for the legal defense of these Baltimore cops. There are news articles about this, too, if you Google it. So Bobby Al Jolson Berger, as he came to be known, again, offered his services. He said, "I'll perform in blackface to raise money for your legal defense for killing Freddie Gray." This was so outrageous that it was ultimately canceled. But for a while, it was in the offing. It never came off. But this is all, this is in the age of Obama, and the Northam comes post-Obama. And I wonder, or have wondered, have written about, what Obama, his emergence, his insurgency, his time as president has to do with this all. And it's interesting to think, and I'll just come out and say it, that the election of the first African-American president of the United States occasioned the apparently legitimate return of blackface comedy. Now, again, since the 1960s, this has been no go. This is offensive. You can't do it. And yet, all of a sudden, in 2009, when Obama was president, first we get Fred Armisen on Saturday Night Live doing Obama. Fred Armisen, not black. And blackface, in a weird way, seemed to crop up sort of all over the place. Fred Armisen himself did a blackface Prince on SNL. He also did a blackface and what you might call blindface, since David Paterson was blind, New York Governor David Paterson on SNL. But all of a sudden, there were other instances of it, like Mad Men actor John Hamm doing a blackface skit with Tracy Morgan in a spoof of Amos and Andy on 30 Rock. Jane Krakowski on 30 Rock also did some mock blacking up. Now, all these, again, are kind of making fun of blackface, but still are doing blackface. Fox NFL Sunday's Frank Caliendo blacked up for a broadcast in imitation of black basketball star Charles Barkley. Bill Kristol resurrected his blackface Sammy Davis Jr. from the 80s when he used to do it for the opening segment of the 2012 Academy Awards telecast. And the gang on It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia pursued more than one grease paint remake of Lethal Weapon. There's Robert Downey Jr.'s Tropic Thunder turn and more. Dennis Haysbert had done, you know, a black president, Chris Rock, too, in the 2003 film Head of State. But white or non-black performers in blackface was a new turn on all this. So it's just interesting. But what's particularly interesting about this is that Obama himself got in on the gag. I don't know if it's come to your attention. I almost want to pause here and let you watch for 2 minutes, but I think I won't, since we're hastening and time is short. It's only 2 minutes long, but you know these yearly White House correspondence dinners that presidents do, unless you're Donald Trump, because he doesn't like slightest chance of being teased at all. Obama reveled in these White House correspondence dinners where presidents and others, a dais of distinguished people, get up in front of journalists, the press, and they tease each other. For the 2013 White House correspondence dinner, Steven Spielberg produced a 2-minute little funny bit. And you can watch it on YouTube. And I'll just describe it briefly. in which he's casting around, and it's Spielberg sitting there talking, casting around for what the heck is he going to do after having done Lincoln? I've done Lincoln. Oh, the audience chat is great. I wish I could respond. I will eventually. What am I going to do after Lincoln? And then it hit me, says Spielberg. Obama. So the titles come up on the screen. Steven Spielberg's Obama, just like Steven Spielberg's Lincoln. But who on earth to play him, says Spielberg to himself. As it turns out, the director says the answer was right in front of me all along. Daniel Day-Lewis. Ha ha ha. The actor so brilliant as Hawkeye in Last of the Mohicans, as Bill the Butcher in Gangs of New York, and most recently as Spielberg's Abraham Lincoln, a quick montage of clips certifies. He becomes his characters. And you know what, Spielberg crows? He nailed it. Then there's a cut to this slide that I've given you here, where Obama is sitting there, and it's captioned, Daniel Day-Lewis, method actor. So Obama is in on the joke, and it's a very funny little bit where Obama is pretending to be Daniel Day-Lewis playing Barack Obama. So, like, what to do with this? How to think about it? Daniel Day-Lewis, method actor, like Robert Downey Jr. in Tropic Thunder, in blackface. So that's the joke. So Obama says, was it hard playing Obama? I'll be honest. Yeah, it was, he says. Again, Obama as Daniel Day-Lewis as Obama. Shots of Obama in the mirror follow, practicing his accent. Hello, hello, Ohio. I love you back. For one thing, the actor says, the cosmetics were challenging, and that makes the blackface joke quite obvious. Almost 200 years of blacking up roll into the picture. After a quick, almost obligatory bit with Tracy Morgan talking about his performance as who else, Joe Biden, we're back to Day-Lewis, quote unquote. Obama says, the hardest part, trying to understand his motivations. What makes him tick? Why doesn't he get mad? Why doesn't he get mad? If I were he, I'd be mad all the time. But I'm not him. I'm Daniel Day-Lewis. So then it fades to black on Obama doing his hair in the mirror and checking his hand gestures. So in the face of such a thing, it's hard to decide. Amazing that they thought of it, or just, you know, sort of waiting to happen. Obama as Day-Lewis, as Obama, as I've said, puts Obama in blackface. There's a white man inside him, goes the logic, looking in the mirror and seeing the blackface of power. That face fronts a persona, always reflecting on how to get the performance just right, according to the dictates of white assumptions, white desire. Now, again, this is made with Obama's permission by his friend, Steven Spielberg. It's all in fun, Hollywood liberalism at its best, and yet it's a little bit squirmy in its implications. The performance is always just that, an approximation or copy, never true or originary. The cosmetics are challenging. Obama in this clip, however playful, is blackface Obama, presumptive imposter in many senses. Recall all the familiar charges. He's not really black, he's not really American, he's not really patriotic, etc. Even Cornel West, famous radical, called Obama a Rockefeller Republican in blackface. To which I would remark, why is blackface germane if you're going to charge Obama with conservatism? Why do you need the blackface? Black Republicans do exist. Or is fake blackness the real assertion behind Cornel West's remark? So Steven Spielberg's Obama, in a certain way, you might imagine, was Obama. At least that's what this clip says. Racial ambivalence, and state play acting intact and defining. The way Obama negotiated all this stuff is compelling to me. He clearly knows he's in a unique and unprecedented position. And I think he played with that understanding very well. What do I want to say here? Obama loved to play with his image, his basketball skills. You may have seen the clip of him just casually walking through a basketball court on his way to someplace else, picking up a ball, and from the corner, dropping a three-pointer. His NCAA predictions, which the press played on every year. His yearly iPod playlist. You know, what's he listening to this year? And so forth. Also, his appearances on Between Two Ferns, Zach Galifianakis, Seinfeld's comedians in cars getting coffee. These are charmingly funny turns that depend on Obama's witty playing around with his own blackness. He even had Keegan-Michael Key do his best Obama anger translator at the White House Correspondents' Dinner in 2015. So I'll paint you the picture. This too is on YouTube. Key and Peele, when they were a duo, had this funny thing where Peele would pretend to be Obama, all composed, never getting angry, being angry, but never expressing it, because it's dangerous for a black man to get angry. But Keegan-Michael Key would be the one to express all the things that Obama repressed or suppressed in his persona. So he'd be jumping around the room, shouting, and just going wild. So Obama cleverly had Keegan-Michael Key on the podium with him, being fully composed, playing with his image, and having Keegan-Michael Key behind him, acting out the anger he was supposedly feeling at that moment. So it was a funny turn. It's not that Obama metaphorically donned blackface in his more conservative gestures, as though blackness were essentially good or essentially anything at all. The blackface comes with the contours of white expectation, white fantasy about the president. And this is what Obama was and is exceptionally skillful at playing with. Okay, I don't know where we are with time, but let me look at some questions. Matthew's posted one. I recently learned about digital blackface and how non-black people use images and gifs of black people to react online. I'm wondering how you understand this widespread phenomenon of people using black bodies to express emotion. I would say, I don't know a ton about it. I haven't read a ton about it, haven't studied it, but it seems to me, the acquaintance that I have with the practice, to conform to the kinds of feeling and the political motives and urgencies that I've been describing, in which an other for white people, a black and an internal fantasized other person who is not me, but somewhere, somehow, deep inside, part of me, allows me to express something that I can't as myself express, or that a Black image better expresses than I myself might be able to express it. Seems to me to call on that same dependence on the part of whites and dominant U.S. culture on Black images and the meanings and emotions or affects that Black images put forward that minstrelsy itself did. How direct are any connections between Blackface and early blockbuster film, Birth of a Nation? I think I've addressed that to some extent. If you look at certain scenes, there are many actors in Blackface. Interestingly, the villains, the senator, I forget his name, the northern senator who is corrupt, is in Blackface. And if I'm not mistaken, Gus, the rapist, is also in Blackface, as though to conjure up the worst possible images, but to guard against fully conveying them. I know it's paradoxical, by imaging them with a Black performer in Blackface, as opposed to an actual Black person, as though to call attention to who's calling the shots and who's controlling the images here. The books I mentioned, were they all done by white authors? By no means. Rogan and Salmon definitely are. Amiri Baraka is not. Baraka's book, under the name of Leroy Jones, his name until he changed it, has some penetrating pages on minstrelsy. Did I mention the book? His book is called Blues People from 1963. A classic, still relevant, a great read. Ralph Ellison's work in his essays, Ellison in his collection of essays, Shadow and Act, also great. My research to find that Black men did it to survive. Yeah, very much so. I mean, it becomes, because of this whole history, it becomes, you can make a metaphor out of it in several different ways. The Blackface mask is your ticket to the stage. It's something you have to do in order to get on stage. It's a template, so to speak, for all the images that can be presented on stage. And so ever after, it's a kind of horizon of audience expectation that even Black performers, even when they're not in Blackface, have to deal with, have to surmount, negotiate, circumvent, somehow play with. Like Armstrong was really brilliant, because in a moment, 30s and 40s, of high Blackface in Hollywood, Armstrong takes that mask. He doesn't try to avoid it. He takes that mask, sort of puts it on, and smashes it to bits by just exceeding it, playing so well, playing his horn so well, poking fun in many different ways at all the protocols of minstrelsy, even when he's seeming to enact them. And he's got a version of Swanee River that is critically ironic. Also, there's Armstrong's great song from the 20s, What Did I Do to Be So Black and Blue? That basically plays with the idea of Black skin as a kind of mask that white culture has applied to Black people, something to scale, a burden to bear. Cotton Club, yes, I would say that Cotton Club is heir to a lot of these structures of entertainment and performance, structures of feeling that they gave rise to and sustained. Very definitely, Black performers on stage for white enjoyment, largely white enjoyment. How do we reckon with a significant portion of the American songbook, Stephen Foster, associated with minstrel shows? Well, that's a thorny question and a good one, because songs we learn in school, cleansed of their racist lyrics and their blackface, black scent, and most offensive and offensively racist lyrics like "Oh Susanna," "Don't You Cry for Me," those are rooted in blackface performance. And I think we have to reckon with the fact that there's very little purity to go around here. Like, for example, it used to be commonly thought that there was good rock and roll and there was commercial rock and roll. And the good rock and roll was a mix of, let's say, blues roots and country roots. And that both of those strains, the blues and country, were in some sense pure in a folky sort of way. But when you can go to the Grand Ole Opry stage and find blackface, and when you can go to the blues and find early blues performers like Ma Rainey and W.C. Handy on minstrel stages, then it's a much more murky and complicated situation. And I'm not trying to suggest that these performers are to be indicted because they put on blackface. Well, I sort of am. Only more importantly, to note the complexities that surround all of these performance forms and that surround us still with inheritances like much of the American songbook, Stephen Foster, for example. Why so much blackface during and after Obama's presidency? The easy answer, I think, but I think a defensible one, is that Obama in office was such a threat to orders and regimes of racial dominance in this country that whether it was the police cracking down in the streets on Black people and Black bodies, or in imagery, entertainment venues, a kind of compensatory address to a Black man in power through blackface, there was a kind of counterweight that occurred because of the threat, really, of a Black man in the Oval Office. Okay, so I guess we are having to wrap up here at 8:23. Winding down, not wrapping up. Maybe wrapping up. Perhaps Matthew will indicate what we do now.
Eric, that was extraordinary. And I do want to wrap up, and I want to do so. I want to do so by thanking you first. It's really been an extraordinary journey through the American Songbook, is a good way to put it, but also our complex and fraught relationship with our cultural inheritances. And I think that's the of the many things that you said today. I'm struck by the ways that which seems pure is impure, and the I guess I'm just really struck by the complexities of how we inherit this material. And, you know, your image here that you left up for us of Obama and his anger translator gets at the ways that even in the midst of what is fundamentally a cultural phenomenon you say is rooted in enslavement, a person, a powerful cultural actor like Obama can work with and against that tradition. And I find that so provocative, so powerful, and can't wait to read more of your work.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Eric Lott, for being with us and for spending this time with our teachers. And thank you to the audience as well for delivering such a serious and interesting set of questions for Eric to engage with. It strikes me that this is very much a question that belongs in your classrooms and that you're thinking about yourselves. I want to remind the audience to stay up to date on center events through our social media feeds. And I want to announce the next webinar in the series. I'm going to just go ahead and put up our last couple of slides here. Our next webinar in the series is with Juliana Barr. And it's charting a path between textbook maps and historical cartography to teach indigenous history. That will be February 16th at 7 p.m. Juliana Barr, Associate Professor of History in the Department of History at Duke University. So, Eric Lott, teachers, thank you for this extraordinary experience. I'm deeply grateful to you both, and I'll look forward to seeing you on our next webinar. Good night.